Just the other week, Microsoft dropped this repo for Edit, the very creatively named Terminal Text Editor, based on the MS-DOS editor of the same name. Or, better yet, Edit.com, which might be one of the most dot-com bubble names you will ever see. Now, this new edit tool is written in Rust, because as you know, this is the only language you're allowed to use when starting up a new project. C be gone, C be damned, who cares about every other language? Rust is the only correct choice. Now, being a Rust application, I could have gone and used Cargo, compiled the application, did all that fun stuff myself. I didn't want to do that. I didn't really care enough. However, there is a package in the Arch Linux repos, ms-edit. Now, the way this is going to be named is probably going to be different on different distros. The reason why it's named like this and why the binary is also ms-edit is there is usually going to be another program also called edit. As you may guess from the way it looks here, this is part of the Vim line, the Vi line, the EX line, and we can use all of those fun commands we can do here. I'm not going to use that version of edit today. Let's go and run ms-edit instead. Now, the very first thing you probably notice here is it kind of looks like a 2E version of classic Notepad. Not modern Notepad, which has like a bunch of extra buttons, AI integration, all that stupid annoying things, but classic Notepad you'd see on something like, you know, Windows 7 or anything older. And it makes sense because it is emulating the look of MS-DOS Editor, so I'd be very surprised if this didn't influence the early design of Notepad as well. Frankly, it is a functional text editor, and that's basically what you should expect from this. This is not going to be Vim. This is not going to be Emacs. It's more akin to something like Nano, but if Nano was written with Microsoft Design Language. As should be very self-evident, it does not look like a Unix or a Linux text editor. There is menus up the top here that are controlled with mouse control. Some applications you will see this, but definitely not for a text editor. And like Nano, we can just start typing as we please. There's no like weird key combination to start typing. There's no modes or anything like that. I will explain all this stuff down the bottom here afterwards, but it's basically just a 2E version of Notepad. Now, nicely, it does have number lines on by default on the side. Maybe on by default isn't the best way to say it, because I'm not seeing any way to configure it. And on the GitHub page, there's no mention of configuration either. Basically, you just get what you get. I don't think there's a config file. If there is, it's not mentioned anywhere. And none of these up here take me towards like a configuration section. So, again, is basically a 2E notepad, you get what you get. With the exception of these along the bottom here, which I'll get to a bit later. Now, unlike Nano, we don't have all of our key combinations listed along the bottom here. That doesn't mean they aren't listed anywhere. So under each of these menus, the key combinations for each of the actions are going to be listed. But this is a 2E editor. Yes, it is nice to be able to do this with your mouse, but what if I don't want to check it with my mouse? So under each of these menus, you might notice an underline. So F for file, E for edit, V for view, and H for help. If I press Alt and then F, it takes us into the menu, and then we can key through it with our arrow keys. If there's something I want to go and use, like say, new file, I can press Enter, and that is going to be run. Now, if I don't like the menu I'm in, if we press the escape key, it's gonna take us back to the menu list, and we can go and arrow key through those. If we press escape again, now we go back to the editor. Now, like I said before, it's not Vim, it's not Emacs, but for a simple text editor, it's not missing anything obvious. All of the basic functions are going to be here. One neat thing under file is we have a separate close editor and exit. So close editor is control W. That is just going to close the current file we were in. Now, in this case, we actually had two files open at the same time. I'll show you more about that a bit later. If we go Control Q, this is going to try to quit the entire thing. Gives us the option to save or don't save or cancel, whatever I want to do. Now, if I have an unsaved file like this one here is, if we try to close the editor, it is going to prompt us to save as well. Now, let's go and open a new file with Control N. I'm going to put some text here. I'll open another one. Bunch of stuff here, another one, and there we go. Now, normally, you'd be able to go and press Control-P. My terminal is actually overriding that key combination to do something else. So if we go to View, then Document Picker, this lets us go and select which document I want to be in. So let's go back to Untitled 1, the one we started in, and now all of our original text is back. If we do that again, we can go back to any of the other documents, like this one here, and there we go. And as you may have noticed, it is going to order them based on how recently you did access them. With just a few files open, this isn't that big of a deal, but as you get more and more and more, this doesn't have any sort of filtering system, fuzzy find system, anything like that. So you will have to go and manually key through them or, you know, select it with your mouse. There's just no filtering system to easily find it. Where this becomes more of an issue is opening a file. So that is on Control O. So with there being a text field here, you might think, oh, there's a big list of things. If I start typing, like, say, dot ZSO. Even though there is a text field, this is just a text field for writing the name of a file. It is not a text field that is going to do any sort of filtering. So here is my ZSHEMF, but for longer file names, it might be really annoying to go and access them. Let's go and close that file with Control W, and a lot of the other functionality you expect to see here is gonna be here as well. We have undo, redo, cut, copy, paste. There is a find. This has matching case, whole word, and regex. Always lovely to see. We have replace and also select all. Under the view section, we also have a word wrap, which is nice to see as well. So let's go and type a bunch, we'll make that smaller, bunch of text here, put some spaces. Look at that, wow. If a word goes over the line, it does a word wrap. Lovely, great, we love word wrapping. Always, always good to see. And of course, you can also go and jump to a specific line as well with the Control G. Actually, let's put in some more lines here. And Control G, jump to line, I don't know, 9, and there we go. Now, the thing along the bottom here, this is referred to as the status bar. Now, as it stands, it might seem like the only way to interact with this is by using your mouse. And that is mostly true. So if we go to the view section, there is a thing here called focus status bar, and then we can go and arrow through it. As you notice though, for some reason, it does not have a hotkey. So that's weird. So the best way to do it with your keyboard is Alt V, and then you can do it from that. Why it doesn't have a dedicated key combination? I couldn't tell you. So down here, we have the very limited configuration that is available. Firstly, we have line feed or carriage return line feed. If you don't know why you would want one or the other, basically just don't bother touching it because frankly, it doesn't really matter that much with modern software. In the past, it mattered a lot more. So just ignore it. One you also probably want to ignore unless you know exactly what it does is the text encoding. By default, it is set to UTF-8, and there are quite a few options here. A lot of IBM options, I don't know what any of those mean. Frankly, outside of like, let's see, down to about, I actually don't even know, what is UTF-7? Down to about here, everything else, maybe except this one, US ASCII. Everything else, not a clue what context you would use it in, but it is supported. But like with the other menus, if you want to select something, we can arrow down with it and then press enter and it is selected. Now, before that creates any problems later on, Let's go focus on the status bar, change it back to UTF-8, and there we go. Now, a setting that you might actually want to mess with is this one here. By default, is set to spaces 4. This lets you do the very important thing of choosing what your tab key does. Should your tab key produce spaces or tabs? And if it's going to be tabs, how big are those tabs going to be? Now, the correct answer is always spaces. There is some debate about how many spaces you want to use, whether it's 2 or 4, but it is configurable as you please. If you choose tabs, you are objectively wrong. Feel free to fight about it in my comment section over whether tabs or spaces are better. It is great for the algorithm. As for the thing after that, that is your number line and the character your cursor is currently positioned on. So right now we are on line number 2, character number 4. If I go down here, line 18, character 4, or let's say line 19, character 2. As for the asterisk next to it, I have been playing with this software for a couple of hours. I have never seen the asterisk change. I have absolutely no idea what it's supposed to mean, what it's supposed to do. So if anybody has any idea, feel free to let me know in the comment section. And then the final thing we have here is another way to access the document picker that we saw from the view menu here. Now, the help section doesn't have any help, actually. It just has an about telling you that it's Microsoft Edit. So, very useful help section. It would be nice if that wasn't even a menu and about was just right here. Honestly, the reason it's probably like that is whatever library or however they've written the UI for this, it probably doesn't allow for things to be styled like this and then also be clickable in this menu. Or like things in this menu have to be submenus, something like that. Because if you only have one menu element, there's no reason to have a submenu at all. So here's the deal. This is not going to be my daily driver text editor anytime soon. But with just a little bit more polish, like, you know, the lack of a key binding here, and then the lack of fuzzy finding here, I do think it would be a perfectly passable text editor where if I was on a system and it was the only thing available, I wouldn't be bothered using it, even in the current state, for editing a single file. It's fine. Like, if I just want to edit, like, a, you know, shell script or a config file, like, it's fine. It's not great. It's not amazing, but, like, it's a plain text editor, and it edits plain text. That's all it needs to do. Albeit, the emphasis on menus is a tad strange for a terminal editor, but again, it's basically just a TUI notepad. And if you like Notepad, and you like TUIs, it's totally fine as an option. But what do you think? Is this something you would ever actually find yourself using? If you happen to be on a system where it was the only thing available, would it bother you? Let me know your thoughts down below. So if you like the video, go like the video. If you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Silly Bear, pay linked in the description down below. That's gonna be it. Okay, that's gonna be it for me. I had something I was gonna say, I forgot.